Today on the podcast, we have Sonja, Ashley, and David, collectively known as Throuple Time on Instagram. Thank you guys so much for joining us today.
So excited to talk to you guys.
Welcome. Thanks for having us.
Can you guys tell us a little background, how you guys all met, how you became a throuple? How did you guys become Throuple Time?
We want to know it all.
All right. Okay. I can get us started. First off, thank you guys for having us on this podcast, and thanks for even putting this podcast together. We have just loved all your throuple interviews. They've been kind of normalizing for us. Mm-hmm. So I just want to put that out there before we dive into how we all got together. Okay. Let's see. So, okay. Taking it back, Dave and I are a little bit different. We were together before we met Ash, but we haven't been married. We were high school and college sweethearts. And my junior year of college, we broke up. We had been together since I was, 15. And we broke up. And we didn't talk for 18 years. We married other people. We had our families. And during COVID, Dave reached out to make sure I was okay. And we were living in the same small town, which we didn't really know that much. We kind of run into each other every so often and kind of stay away from each other because we had so much history. But he reached out during COVID and was like, "How are you doing?" I was like, "I'm doing good." And then he was like, "Can I ask you a hard question?" And I was like, "I don't know." Like, "Oh, yeah, you can." And he said, "Why on earth didn't we make it? I feel like you're the one that got away."
Good question, right?
I love it.
It's a very good COVID question as well. I think a lot of people were like, right? You know what? Life is short. We're going to ask these things that have been,
good point,
have been driving us nuts.
Totally. But we were like, we're married, we had kids. So we got on he's like, "Can we go to video chat?" And I'm like, "Oof. Oh, now we're really good." And we went on video chat, and both of us, the first 5 minutes of the video chat was like, "Holy crap. Holy moly. Oh, just seeing each other and being like energetically connected again." We're like, "Oh man. Oh man." And it was like a couple minutes into the podcast, Dave was we weren't doing a podcast. No. Dave was like, "Oh my God, I'm still in love with you." Mm-hmm. And I was like, "I've always been in love with you." And we were like, "Crap, what do we do about that?" It was like awesome, but also like heartbreaking because just didn't know. It wasn't like unresolved issues. We hadn't talked in 18 years. So that led to like 6 months of therapy, a lot of like staring out the window, like, what are we going to do? And ultimately we had to take the leap and go for being together again. So we went through that process. And I think really the same week Dave and I reconnected was the week that I met Ash for the first time through a mutual friend. And we ran together for like
probably like past 3 years. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We've been running together for a while.
Probably 2 years of like, we ran together. I trained her for a few big races. She ran a 100-mile race.
Wow.
That I trained her for. She's awesome.
Took second place.
She did. She took second place. Nice. Because of the phenomenal coaching.
You'll do a lot for love, you know? I really want to coach. I guess I'll run 100 miles.
And Dave and I, as we got together and started living together, blending our families, we have 3 kids between us. Dave has 2. I have 1. Ash has 2. We were kind of like, we've been in monogamous relationships for a long time, 18 years or so. Maybe we could like do some monogamish stuff.
Monogamish.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know. We kind of experiment with it. And tried a little bit of that, but we always knew that Ash and her partner, female partner, were open. And so we kind of like fantasized about them a bit. Like, they were so pretty. And Dave's like, "We should try. Like, we should try." And I looked at him. I'm like, "Babe, like, they're too pretty for us." Like,
she literally said they date Abercrombie models. Like, you got no chance.
Challenge accepted. I know. I love it.
What were you thinking about, Ash? Were you thinking about them in that way?
I hadn't thought about them quite there at that point. I mean, I'd been running with Sonja as a friend for years. I was in a monogamous relationship, or like all of my previous relationships, were hetero and monogamous. And then when I was with my ex-wife now, we were in an open marriage, but we didn't really define exactly what that meant. We navigated that through this process. And when we met them, we were open. And my wife was like, well, we should, like, maybe something could happen. I was like, I don't know. Like, this is my friend where they live local. I'm not sure about this. And
how did it happen, Ash?
We went to a charity event, and
we had a party bus.
And on the party bus, I was like, you know what? I really want to make out with Sonja. And so my ex-wife was totally fine with that. And
Dave was like, you should do that.
Yeah. She said, I'd really like to make out with your wife. And she's not my wife, but that's what she said. I'll never forget. You should totally do that.
And me, like, I really identified as straight for most of my life. When we decided to go monogamish, I was like, yeah, I can hook up with girls. Like, I didn't really self-identify as bi. Yeah. But I definitely was like willing to play, willing to have fun. And that was kind of where I was at in my sexuality. And then Ash kissed me, and I don't know, that was probably the first moment that I was like really into a woman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Even though I had like played and experimented up to that point, it was just sex. There wasn't really any emotions. And I think because we already had a really emotional relationship that wasn't sexy, but we had been through a lot of like hard things together. So it was kind of sin. So yeah, then what happened?
Yeah. After I woke up the next day, I was like, ooh, I hope everyone's okay with that. And they were like, actually, we would like to go to Portland and we should go on a trip together. Mm-hmm. And my ex at the time was like, absolutely, let's go to Portland. Like, let's live this wild weekend. And I kept saying, I don't know, they're local. Like, what if this gets dicey? And we all agreed to go on this trip to a sex club in Portland, had a wonderful experience. We all were super connected after. Uh-huh. And after that, the four of us really continued. We were a really happy four. We had multiple check-ins. We meshed well. We could see each other when we could, and we had our kids. We went our separate ways, and then we would come back together and do fun date nights. We went on trips together. Mm-hmm. And then 6 months into this, my ex realized that she was more into the open marriage for the sexual aspect more than the intimate aspect. Mm-hmm. And I was more into the intimate connected. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to move forward saying I could have more than one person that I love. And she said that I'm struggling with you loving more than one person. Mm-hmm. So we kind of came to an ultimatum standpoint. And I said, well, I can't not love this other woman now and man. And I,
woman,
yeah, one at a time. And I don't, so I like, I would feel like I'd be emotionally cheating. I would like to take a separation. And through that time, I think we both realized that our expectations and needs were different. We're very amicable. And she's now with a man and very happy. And we ended up together through this separation process, but we had a lot of understanding of what we thought going into an open marriage would be like. And then realizing that I have that poly aspect that I really think you can love more than one person. And I felt like I really could do that with multiple partners. And so then we got together, and eventually Dave and I's relationship finally grew some too, because, you know, prior my wife is a little bit more, she's very heterosexual. Even married to me, I would still call her hetero. But I think her being with a man and Dave being there kind of made sense. And so Dave and I didn't really have our relationship grow until after we were mm-hmm. three, mm-hmm. the three of us just thrive. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was a given. We saw it early.
Yeah, nice. We did see it early. And my feelings for Ash were like really quick. And Dave kept being like, you love her. Like, no, don't tell me what I, nuh-uh, like, you love her. And then we went backpacking.
Yeah, they came back from a trip backpacking. I'll never forget.
Backpacking.
And they shared a tent, and she came back and told me the story. And I'm like, that's not just a hookup, man.
Yeah.
How did that make you feel, Dave? How did that make you feel?
Great. I thought I have through this whole thing had like a day or two of jealousy, like at a certain point. But besides that, I've always thought if it feels good for her, then it's a good mm-hmm. thing. And Ashley's lovely, and we've got really, really close. So those two were definitely had a connection that was very obvious to me really early. But yeah, it's never really been an issue. Compersion is a word I didn't even know before this whole process. I'm like, they call me the king of compersion. So
nice. I love it.
I've always enjoyed it. Yeah. I enjoy them together and they love each other. It's really, really sweet. And it's been great.
That's beautiful.
It's been interesting to like start to understand how it is four relationships. Mm-hmm. But all of the relationships kind of have a completely different dynamic. And I think we all prefer the three person relationship. Like mm-hmm. that's really how we jive. Just everyone feels complete when we're together as a three. And we felt that really early on, like whenever the three of us were together, it was just what all of us wanted was to just be a three. But it took us a while to kind of sort things out and get there.
Nice. So originally when you guys all met, were you all married to other people?
Had gone through a divorce really recently, went through Dave's divorce, and then went through Ash's divorce. So I'm like,
those two got divorced for each other to reconnect from their high school sweetheart.
Okay.
And then they were just figuring out probably a year. Like when we started running, they were talking through their separations, and then they got divorced when Sonja and I were friends running, we did a lot of long like road trips. So we had a lot of time to talk about this. And then probably a year and a half later is when my wife at the time and I had met them, and we were all like, I think it was about a year.
It was like 6 months after we moved in together that the party bus happened.
Yeah.
Okay. So kind of happened. So yeah, we didn't necessarily have a lot of time. Like we hear a lot of couples that are married and have been married for a long time and kind of have that foundation before they bring in a third. We didn't really have that. We had just gotten through pretty gnarly divorce, not on my end, but on Dave's end. And we had just lived together for like 6 months when we got together with Ash and her partner. And then that, like another 6 months later, we were a three. And so Ash had to really go through Dave and I's like next phase of our relationship and figuring that out. And she was like middleman, triangulation to the max, but she really helped us like get through some pretty challenging stuff in our own relationship while being part of this three situation.
I imagine that would be quite challenging because you're all trying to get over past relationships, going through a divorce, while trying to figure out how to be a throuple and how all these four relationships now work. I imagine that'd be quite challenging.
Well, and none of us would really, you know, I think a lot of people maybe stem from more of like a poly standpoint, but all of us were pretty much monogamous. Like even in my open marriage, like that was a stepping stone into what we ended up in. So I think just to not have that, we just didn't have any information. We kind of went into it blindly.
For sure.
And then we didn't have a lot of resources to go. We were like, what is it called? Oh, it's called a throuple.
Yeah.
Okay.
You guys didn't buy the guidebook.
It's a weird term, but I get it. All right. It's uncomfortable, but I'll work it. And then now what do we do? You know, and so as we were going through this whole process, we were really kind of like discovering this other world that no one really was part of prior, but open to. Well,
and I think as you all know, there's no like handbook. Like we're like, where's the handbook that shows how you do this or how this all works? We searched, she searched for sure all over for like.
Yeah, I'm the researcher.
How do you handle an argument or how do you handle these different situations?
I'm like looking up the, I'm in like the library, you know, for school and I'm looking at all the research articles and I'm like throuple, zero.
Yeah, zero. Uh-huh.
Yeah. I add two, you know, it's just like, there's no research. I found like 8 research articles on compersion and jealousy, polyamorous relationships, but nothing really about like throuples or triads or close triads.
How to make
them work. So, but that's also a gift, right? Because we said many times, well, then we get to make it up. Like we don't have all these previously conceived notions about like monogamy, heterosexual monogamy. There's like all these boxes that you can fit into, but we didn't have any boxes. So we had to use our own like love and ideas and conversations to chart the direction we're going to go.
I think the other part that was interesting for me, at least personally, was none of your friends have any idea to give you any advice. Like in a normal relationship, with a friend and say, oh, I had an argument with my wife or girlfriend last night and everyone's got some input, but nobody has anything to say or have any clue what to do.
Yeah.
So that's kind of an extra challenge, I think.
That's what's been nice about this Facebook group that we started for Throuples, because as soon as I find it, even people have been Throuple for 3-4 years, they're like, I wish this existed 4 years ago. But they're constantly throwing questions in there like, hey, what, you guys ever done this before? And everybody's so quick to jump in there and help and support.
If you're in a Throuple, being in your guys's connection hub is like slam dunk. And honestly, even if you're a Throuple that doesn't have a lot of questions, because you like you're in your role, we need you in there.
Yeah, like, answers.
We need you to join.
I'm like, tell us what to do. All of our friends are like, interesting.
Where's our elders at?
Right. No. It's very, we hear that all the time. You guys are not alone. Every single Throuple that we interviewed, ourselves included, we didn't know what we were doing. It was a trial and error.
Yeah. It's like you said too, you'd look up for information. You put Throuple, nothing comes up.
No. It's one better of the now when you Google that, it.
Video on Instagram today of them trying to get Alexa to find Throuple talk.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
It's like Throuple talk.
Alexa doesn't know what the heck Throuple is.
It's not a word.
Neither does Google.
No, we did it yesterday.
What did they say? Like Throuple?
No, Throuple. We were
Throuple. Yeah.
We're going to this, Europe this summer. And so I was like, how do you say Throuple in French? And it gave me the word for throttle. Throuple. Like Throuple. So
I believe it's menage a trois.
Ah, yes.
That's a threesome, right? But we're looking for
it's more like menage a trois is like doing life together.
Household of three
people unit. Yes.
Which is what we do. So it's actually the perfect.
Yeah, it's what we do, but I feel like it's been kind of hijacked and sexualized, but in reality it's doing life together.
That's great. Wow, that's awesome.
I wonder if it's hijacked in France. Maybe it's
I
not.
Don't know. Yeah, I have no idea.
We'll let you know.
Perfect. Yes. So since you're traveling to Europe, what is different now that you travel as a Throuple than it would be if you would be a couple? Give us any Throuple traveling tips.
Okay.
We travel a lot.
We travel a ton. As you know, we have 5 kids and 3 custody schedules.
So oh my God.
Ours is really easy.
Ours are week on, week off. Although my 18-year-old is with us a ton. So she's not really week on, week off anymore. Ash's are little. They're 6 twin girls. Adorable. So they can't really be week off, week on, week off yet. Cause they're little. So they're a little more all over the place. So when we get kid free time, we're like, get us out of here. Like, we want out, but we don't get big chunks of time, really no more than a week ever.
Yeah.
So this summer we coordinated all the custody and we got 2 weeks that we get to go somewhere, and we're so excited about it. Throuple travel is interesting.
Uh-huh.
We're at our best when we're traveling together, I would say.
I feel like it starts when you like book the reservation and you ask like, is it a 2-person or a 3-person? And so right there, you're already like a little bit marginalized.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It makes sense. Mm-hmm. And so it's either like 2 queens, mm-hmm. one, and like, oh, we'll take the 1 king.
Yes.
Usually like we can kind of catch it before, but we just recently went to Mexico and they were insisting like, no, we got you 3 beds.
They got us 3 twin beds.
Oh, so kind of it.
We want 1 king. They're like 2 queens. We're like, no. And the guy just looked at us and we're like, do you have a manager?
I didn't even know they had rooms with 3 twins, but they did. I've never heard of that.
Yeah, me neither. It's the first.
I'm sorry.
What'd you say?
I said, me neither. It's the first. I've never heard of 3 beds in one room like that.
I was like, yes, they even do that option. Like, now we got a third option to deal with.
I don't know. I think I would take that option. I want a good night's sleep. Yeah, I'll take my own bed.
Is that because my cat has you on a bed?
The other night, I'm sleeping on the edge of the bed, 1 leg off on the cord of the mattress, and I'm pushed as far up against Sara as I can be. And I'm like, and I'm so tired. I'm trying to figure out, why is she not moving? I look over her, and she's smashed up against Liv. And Liv is sleeping at a 45 degree angle across the entire king bed so that the cat can have a whole corner. Are you kidding me?
So we can fit 4 in our bed.
Okay. Yeah,
we can go dog, 2 cats, 2 girlfriends, 1 boyfriend. And it's intense.
It's cats tight.
Between the legs, dogs between the legs.
I mean, even the queen's not bad because then you get like one bunk bed and one sleeping bed.
Exactly. Yeah. I don't want to sleep in that nightmare when we're done anyway. It's just a sweaty mess of sheets.
What happened over there last night? Okay.
Yeah, but travel's been great. You know, we get fun, like we get some funny looks as people try to figure us out. If we go on like a group boat tour, sometimes we'll try to rent a boat just for us. Mm-hmm. We're lucky in that way. And then we get really crazy. But if we go on a tour, you know, you can feel the like, what's their, you know,
what's going on?
Yeah.
He just, I know she just kissed her.
Yeah.
And then she's got her hand on his thigh.
Like, I wonder if she knows that she just kissed her.
Yeah. To do that. We like to like one person walk away for a little while and then the other two kind of make out.
Yeah.
And then the one comes back.
And they're watching it. Yeah.
And then people are like, oh, she just kissed him. Yeah.
Oh, no.
Remember we were in Vegas that one time we rented that day bed and there was that couple off to the corner and they were watching us like hawks. They were trying to figure out what the heck is going on.
Once you know people are watching, you're like, you know what? We're here.
Yeah.
Let's just get them.
Give them something to talk about.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Exactly. And we do make friends everywhere we go. And then we sort of just explain it all. And then people are like, oh. And we, I mean, then they give us a fair shake. We really, the only people who give us shade are the people we don't get to talk to.
Yeah.
And like tell them what's up. But when we do, I don't know, we're all three really friendly.
Yeah. These two are the same. They're always friendly and explaining things to everyone. And I'm very much an introvert. And I'm like, oh my God, there we go again. But they have to explain our mission to everyone. They're good. They're good spokespeople.
Yeah. And we have been met with a lot of friendliness as well. Yeah. People are like totally like,
that's
oh,
true. Okay. Everyone that we actually, that you actually spoke to, they were very friendly, very open, very understanding. Yeah.
We still have to request like three towels, three robes.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Mm. Yep.
Yeah. No, asking for extra towels, there's always a thing.
One more set.
The extra towel is a thing.
Oh, they never
when we go to make
towels.
Dinner reservations at the resort and they're like, four, we're like, three, four, three.
do you guys all live together?
Mm. We have two houses. They're 11 blocks apart.
We live in a very small town. Our town is 14,000 people, so it's a small town.
Wow.
What state?
That is small.
California.
Okay.
The Central Coast. Yeah. So we have like a golf cart, electric scooters, an electric bike, because we're like, boom, boom, boom. Our kids are boom, 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 back between the houses. When Ash was going through her separation and all of that, we got another house so she could have like a dedicated place for her little girls. I think with my 18-year-old, who was an only child for 15 years, who then had Dave's two, and then if we brought the twin girls in, I think her head would have exploded. So we kind of have had to run at the level of our kids, honestly. Like, we all would be great living together. But we
try to be respectful.
We try to be respectful. We have five kids. They're all in different stages of finding out and understanding our relationship. So we just try to be really kid-forward and kid-focused. And we're just lucky we have the means to be able to operate two houses. Yeah.
No, that makes sense.
We're mostly together. Most nights, the three of us are together.
What, three nights out of 2 weeks when there's like just a different, but otherwise we prefer to sleep, I would say, together.
Yeah.
Char and I are from Sacramento. We lived there most of our lives.
Okay.
And right before we left, I researched it to death and bought the fastest electric scooter I could find on the internet. And I used to ride it to the downtown area for the bars. So you'd have to drink and drive.
It even has a name.
Scooter McGavin. But since we moved here, that thing's got cobwebs. I've never used it one time. They don't even have sidewalks in Texas. It's like,
it's great here. Weather's pretty, you know, 65 sunny every day.
Yeah.
So nice.
What city on the coast?
We're in Los Osos, which is outside of San Luis Obispo.
Oh, nice.
Kind of like halfway between LA and Santa Barbara.
Mm-hmm. Perfect.
We missed the Pismo dude.
Yeah, we used to go to Pismo all the time.
We're right by there.
Yeah. We have yet to find another. We actually, all of our travels, all of our around town, and we're pretty open. So we're like, if there's a throuple out there, they're going to come meet us. And we have yet to ever run into another throuple. And the first time we do, it's going to be bonkers.
We're
so excited.
Well, the Throuples are down in LA.
Yep, they're in LA. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
no.
We need to head down there. We don't go to LA too often.
Mm-mm. Disneyland.
Yeah. the Disneyland.
I think everybody loves Disneyland.
Except for you. Everybody.
You don't have to make that public.
we always had season passes when we lived there. We went like 1 week a month and lived. Thought it was the worst state in the entire world.
I saw something really interesting on your Instagram. I saw you three in on Halloween with your costume. I think the three of us have always talked about what costumes are good for throuples. So tell me about the costume.
We're at Disneyland. We're at Disneyland.
Ash is like first time since she was little.
First time, yeah.
We're huge Disney fans. All our kids love Disney. And we're like, Ash, we're at the point in our relationship.
We need to know if you can handle it.
We need to know.
Disneyland is a lot.
So we took her to three and we had like Throuple Disneyland and we were in line one time and it was like, what's your Disney character? Like, who are you? And we're like, who's Ash? And then we realized like that, like she's Tinkerbell. Like,
I got a little temper, you know, I get a little moody.
She's mischievous. Yeah.
She caused trouble and then I get a little moody.
Yeah. And then we realized like, oh my gosh, Peter Pan and Wendy were like the OG.
This is an opportunity here.
Yeah. And he's the boy that never grew up.
Yes.
Truth.
So we like, it was just a slam dunk. Like it is a perfect representation of our situation. I'm like, come on now, guys. Like,
she's the calling force.
Take it down a notch. And Dave's like, I'm never growing up. And Ash is like,
I love it. That is so awesome.
I took that quiz three times and I got Captain Hook every time. I said, forget it. Yeah.
But they're the total OG Throuple, though, right? The original Throuple is Wendy, Tinkerbell, and Peter Pan.
So. You're right. You're right.
No, that was awesome. When I saw it, I thought about you, Josh, because you're always thinking, what costumes can we have?
I know.
Halloween?
It's hard. Yeah.
It is. Yeah, like something that coordinates.
We did. There was another really good one, but I can't think of it now. But we were like, oh, we got to write that down.
Rock, paper, scissors.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. A good one. We did Adam, Eve, and Lilith.
Yeah. That was kind of desperate.
Yeah. It was a hard one.
But they both wanted to go with scissors for some reason. So I don't
know. I wonder why.
That's great. So how out are you guys everywhere else? Like, are you out at work and with family and everything? Or
Still
something you don't know?
Yeah, this took a minute. Yeah. I mean, we have a public Instagram page, so
it took a while though. We've been together for 2 years. We hit it for the first year and a half. Because we do live in a small town. I have a religious, conservative, military Republican background. And so the first time I came out as gay 7 years ago, or bi, I'll call it bi, it didn't go well. My family disowned me. So it was really quite a traumatic time. And so I've been more hesitant coming out with this, like, oh gosh, if they thought that was crazy, just wait till they hear about a throuple. Like, this isn't going to go good back home. But then also, I work at a hospital and there's just a lot of crossover in the community from our different social groups. And Dave, he luckily like owns his business, but he's on a couple foundations and really, really involved in the community. And then Sonja and I share a ton of mutual friends. I would say not many of them are on the sexual openness platform, but we work out and cross over between training. And so it was a lot. And then we actually have the three ex partners. So we tried to keep it really quiet. But it also, it came to a boiling point probably at the year and a half when we would go out and we didn't want anyone to think we were hiding it, that Dave was cheating on Sonja or Sonja and I were hooking up behind Dave's back. So we eventually had to come out because we're again, a little bit PDA forward, but also just going on dates felt uncomfortable at one point. We ended up telling everyone and we've told probably 200 people in our community, which is a very small community, and just had to come out with a story because nobody even knew I was open. Nobody knew they were exploring. Mm. And so it was really hard to come out because everyone was like, whoa, I thought you were just married with kids. And we're still the same people, but there's another side of me. And we all kind of had to disclose it at probably a faster rate than any of us wanted to, but we did it when it felt right and we just couldn't hide it anymore. And honestly, it's been received well. Like, I think we've had one negative person and 200 people.
Yeah.
Wow. Even my
that's great.
That's interesting.
Even her mom was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it was not what we expected. I think we hit it so long because we were like, ugh. We don't know how people will take it, and everybody just embraced us.
Also, the kids were a big part on too.
The kids that was the scariest part for all of us, I would say. Yeah. But all of our kids have known all of us for a long time. We've been in Ash's girls' lives since they were three. Yeah. And then our kids have seen Ash for years. So it wasn't
we
like,
got lucky with the kids.
Yeah. All our kids, we went out with my 18-year-old daughter first. And she was really surprised because I was like, I'm in love with someone else. And she was like,
again.
And I was like, around like every day for like Ashley. And she's like, no. Because I kind of thought she must have suspected. She was like, no way. I was like, wow, Annie, like you're. So
I told her like a year earlier. Yeah. She's been for a long time.
Yeah.
Yes.
And she's been great. You know, like our,
they're just
these kids love Ash. These kids love us. So it wasn't as hard as we thought.
And who helped us through that was actually Dr. Rachel, who we had on the show a week or two ago. We've gone to her several times and she helped walk us through that process.
Awesome.
And did an awesome job. And after we got off that call, we were like, okay. And I think 2 days later we told all the kids. So
yeah.
She was awesome.
We can't recommend her enough. Like we have her on our website for throupletherapy.com because she's the only therapist we've had so far, you know, licensed, credentialed, there's all the certificates, and but she's in a throuple herself.
Right.
So who else would you want to go to?
Yep. Yeah.
Personal experience. That's how we felt. We're like, oh, someone that understands you.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, she's great.
It was interesting when we first started this, we were in a huge poly network, and most of the people we met through that, they were, you know, more liberal leaning, usually didn't have kids, kind of lived downtown, midtown type areas. And we're this like suburban conservative. It's like, we do not fit in with this, you know, but we started doing this podcast. We started interviewing people and it actually turned out to be most of the throuples we interview lean a little conservative, they suburban, shop at the Costco, kids play soccer. It's like, it wasn't what I thought it was going to be at all. It's been very interesting. Most people come from a deeply religious background.
Yeah. At least one person in every throuple for the most part is very, very conservative. Religious.
I heard you say that the other day in one of the podcasts I was listening to, that there seems to always be one person in the throuple. And I was like, oh, shit.
There's one ex-evangelical in every throuple.
I say that all the time. I'm like, I'm so glad I was able to recognize, because, you know, in high school, I was like, gay is bad. This is like, obviously they choose that. And I was like, wait up, like, why would you want your life to be harder? Like, it sounds like you would choose an easier path if you didn't like truly organically wake up that way. And so I had like just my distance in high school. And then by college, I think I figured it out for myself. But I tell them all the time, I struggle between the two worlds. I have that like part of me that's very conservative and dealing with the conservative side of my family and some of their family members, but also wanting to be the change for my kids and children and myself. So it's kind of a battle. It's something that I overcome often, you know, or not often, but when it comes up, it's a big feeling for me. But very proud of who I am and excited that I can raise kids in a different environment.
But, that's beautiful. Yeah, it's great. Yeah. Teach the next generation.
Yeah, it's nice. And we're just blessed. Like we're in California, so we also have just a little bit easier time with that. Yeah. And then just a supportive community that we've chosen, our village.
It was surprising though. California usually leads the way in this stuff, but then they're the ones that blocked,
the domestic partnership. The multiple person domestic
partnership. Like, why is that where they draw the line?
It's interesting. Even just, you know, we went to a couple Christmas parties. This was our first like season coming out and everyone's like, oh, are all three of you going to come? I was like, yes, the throuple's going to be out. And one of the doctors was like, so do you need another invite? I was like, don't marginalize me, doc. You know, like, joking. Friends, I was like, but yes, I need three invites and we won't come without three. And then people took pictures of us while we're out. So we've adjusted to that. Like we've been people send pictures around of the three of us out. Mm-hmm. We've kind of like
send them to our ex-spouses.
Mm-hmm.
Catch us.
I have a very angry ex-spouse. And so they take photos of us and we'll send it to her.
Yeah. So you kind of have to learn to, luckily we're pretty strong, like personalities in general and a little thick skin, but it's definitely like you're paving the way that's not normal around here and or just not conventional. And it's been interesting dealing with some of the a little bit of backlash through other people that aren't our community. Mm-hmm.
And also wondering, when are people going to come up with better questions than who sleeps in the middle? It seems like that's what
cares
about, is who sleeps in the middle.
That's what our daughter, your daughter, like our daughter, your daughter, our daughter. That was her first question.
Yeah.
And then she
asked that. So she's 10 and I'm telling her. And so again, she's known Ashley. Ashley's been around forever. And she's like, wow, I'm glad you're telling me, Dad. Like I've seen a picture in Sonja's phone of them kissing. So like Sonja was taken out with Ashley without me knowing.
Uh-huh.
And so I'm like, oh no, you know, this has been going on a little while. We just wanted to wait to tell you until we knew it was lasting and real. Like that's one reason we waited as long as we did too. Make sure we knew it was super solid. And she said, well, who sleeps in the middle? Was her first question, which is funny. I'm like, Sonja, she's like, all the time. I'm like, yep, she's our middle spoon. You guys ever have a threesome kiss? And I was like, oh.
I was like,
she's asking, do we all together? I'm like, we've done it, but it's honestly a little awkward. We're not great at it, but yeah. we've given it some tries. Those were her two big questions.
And then a couple of times after, she would refer to us as the threesome.
Interestingly, three is much more natural than four. With four, you end up just pairing off into pairs. But the three, as you all know, the three is pretty magical.
Yeah. Three is the lucky number.
Yes. Well, I'll tell you who sleeps in the middle for us. It's the cat. And we all sleep on the left side and the right side's open. Side.
When I hear about couples that interchange the middle, I'm like, you guys.
We're like, don't listen to that.
They all share the middle. And they're like, no.
Actually, most everyone, right?
Are you going to ask your middle sleeping question?
I am going to ask my middle sleeping question.
Get it out of the way.
But everyone swaps in the middle, right? They change. And mm-hmm. we are the only ones, and you guys are the only ones other than us that don't do that. So that's unusual. We're different in that way. So yes, let me ask my question, Sonja. Where do you keep your stuff? Because you are in the middle. Where do you keep your phone, your water bottle?
Thank you. So I've heard you ask other people this, and I have had that moment.
Yeah,
I lost my nightstand. Sometimes I keep it on Ash's nightstand over there, and then when I want something, I just like reach over. But Ash and I snuggle all night. We are like, we never disconnect. We have like all the snuggle positions. It's one of my favorite parts of being in this throuple is that Ash and I are just connected every night. And then Dave's over here.
And content, very content. I get hot at night. So yeah, people like it.
No cold feet on you in the middle of the winter. Just
I might like slip my hand under him a little bit, but mostly we're just like an entangled, you know, situation. So I just put it on her nightstand. If I need it, I just reach over
the windowsill. You just put the water bottle behind your pillow.
Yeah. So right there, I'll sneak it over. Hair ties have to go up here. Earplugs sometimes go up there. But then the cat ate them all and threw them up.
You have a windowsill situation right behind you. That's what everybody has. We've got this ginormous velvet headboard on both the beds. Each master.
But we also have our beds have these sides. What is it like?
We should call it a safety net because it's what keeps me from falling.
That's why I want to bring it up because I don't know if you thought about it when you decided to get those beds. They're very similar. They have these side like storage and also sit down areas, and they're perfect because when the cat pushes us out of the bed, he gets to sleep on that side.
True story.
What size bed do you guys have?
King.
Yeah.
So we just looked. There's like an Omaha King that's like 96 inches by 96 inches.
We heard about the Alaska King, which is apparently a double.
It is.
Yeah. Yes. I'm waiting for a protection king.
We hear about all these kings. That's so exciting.
We have a Cali King in one house, which is actually narrower and longer. And then we have a King in one house. And when we're in the King, we're like, ooh.
Yeah.
It's actually really good. I don't feel like I need more space. I mean, I'm okay.
These guys are fine too. I get 4 inches on the corner of the bed.
I can get it in 20 minutes. Like the more the merrier. Snuggle me harder.
We did take a while to get the blanket situation sorted out. Like we did one blanket at first and then I couldn't get a leg out.
Yeah.
And I was like trapped. Yeah.
And it took us we did that a long time, and yeah. I just hammered out, like, these are my two people. Aww. I'm okay. It's just what I have to get used to. And then one day the blankets got separated because we have two comforters, and like one went Dave's direction and one went Ash's direction.
And then, the sea parted.
And the sea parted. And so now they each have a blanket, and whoever I'm snuggling, I will pull that blanket over me. But if I want to mosey this way, I'll like put that one off and pull this one over. So I'm just like in heaven.
Yep. Tries to love. They said they sleep the same way.
Yeah.
The throuple we interviewed before you, they said they have two blankets, and the one in the middle chooses which side.
Yeah. We have three separate, which works out pretty good because we all are different temperatures. And they usually have extra blankets. I have like I go between no blanket and light blanket all night.
So
I could easily
regulate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I want to ask you guys, kind of change directions here. Everybody always talks about the importance of communication. And I want to ask specifically for you guys, because you're not living together, what are some special considerations that maybe are things that you do to mitigate couples' privilege, or things that come along with just Ashley not always being present with you guys?
Yeah. It's really hard. Honestly, this has been one of the areas that we've had to seek out help with Dr. Rachel. You know, we've had our fair share of conflict and have had to move through it in the best way possible. The communication's hard. We have like sports schedules, you know, foundation schedules, work schedules, school schedule, like so many schedules, and making sure everyone's on the same page. Especially Ash being on the same page has been challenging in the past. And when she gets left out or doesn't know about a thing that's happening or a thing we've agreed to, that's been incredibly challenging. I don't want to speak for you, but that's been really hard.
We also have great communicator, not great communicator, not great communicator. So
I put my communication like a guy.
Downplay
guys talking, but
it's a bromance.
Ash and I are on the same page on those things.
Don't really communicate well. But I think one of the ways we've mitigated it is probably the schedules. We obviously share schedules, which just helps. And some of the things we'll wake up in the morning and just say, like, what's on your schedule for the day, or what's on tap for the day? Mm-hmm. And that is, we've learned to just not be offended if there's something on the schedule, and just kind of like work ourselves around that. And then we're blessed because I work shift work. And so my hours are like only 3 days a week versus a 5 day a week schedule. And Dave makes his own schedule. That we're able to kind of have Mondays and Tuesdays for the throuple for the most part.
Throuple time.
Nice. That's where the name came from. And so Tuesdays we typically save for like Sonja and I have like an outdoorsy thing, and then we'll have lunch with Dave. And then same with Mondays, will be a lighter schedule for Dave. So he can come in and out as much, and we do lunch and do walks and sunsets and runs and things like that. And then Wednesdays, Sonja sleeps over at my house. To kind of have that girl connection time, especially because they get obviously more time together during their kid weeks. And so we've kind of like found these little workarounds that took a long time. So we went through some hardships, kind of like trying to figure out like, what are your needs? And I'm not good at expressing them. So I'm like, I'm just upset. I'm Tinkerbell. Like, let's use our words. I'm like, that's not going to work for me. I had to play trial and error for a little too long. But now I think we're kind of coming into that, like, how to spread it go both ways, and then just settle into the, it's not always about like comparing it to a monogamous living together, nesting relationship to define yours, to just allow it to be like, we still are just in love and everybody wants to be together, but because of our kids and other things that we've decided not to, and like just settle with that a little bit more. And that's a mindset change. So that's your own work that you need to do. And I think that's what we spent a lot of time working on.
Yeah. And we still do have couples privilege, to be honest. I don't think with a throuple, it's like you get into a throuple and you just like dismantle everything.
No.
It's a journey. Yeah. It's a process. And Dave and I have gotten together pretty recently. So we're still like blending families and figuring ourselves out. You know, I like that all of our relationships are somewhat more recent. While we knew each other when we were young, so we understand like our core, it's not like 15 years of monogamy to dismantle. So I think we're on our way, but we do recognize like it's incredibly hard sometimes when Ash sleeps alone and we've just always got a buddy, even though I use it to catch up on sleep. Like I get my own half of the bed. So I'm usually like, at 8 o'clock, getting like 19 hours of sleep that day. But yeah, we're just making it up, honestly.
And my Wednesday night when I'm by myself, I'm watching Marvel movies, I'm golfing, I'm playing poker with the boys. My Wednesday night by myself is not a lone cry fest, that's for sure. It's
I love that you guys are so aware of the fact that couples privilege is just a factor in your relationship. And I think, I don't remember where I heard it, but before we even met Liv, I remember reading somewhere that you need to come to that realization because there's always going to be something. And I mean, every couple within the throuple is going to have some sort of privileged information at some point. And you just being aware of that, then you can try to mitigate any harmful effects of that. And especially like, you know, you guys are saying you haven't been together that long, but you do live together. Ashley doesn't, like for Josh and I, we were together for a long time before we met Liv. So there's just recognizing that there's going to be certain things that somebody is going to feel left out. And and trying to be aware of that.
It's not as much as trying to dismantle the couple. It's more about learning how to live with it and accommodate.
Yeah. And bring in.
Yeah.
We don't see it as, I don't see it as negative. We talked about that early on. Like one of the reasons I fell in love with you guys, even when I was with somebody, was for your relationship. And I'm not trying to like, let's just dismantle it and make it like it never existed. Like it's part of our story. It's important. It's important for your story. And I think we've just kind of realized that although we're in a triangle, that it'll never be equal on all sides. Mm. And everybody, that's how we talk about it. Like the goal is never to be like equal ever in this relationship, because that would be impossible to like try to compare history, connections, like,
exactly.
But how can we meet everyone's needs to the fullest? And I think that's what we go for, is meeting needs and not just trying to make our relationship like comparable to mine, to yours or his, right. Like we just.
Yeah. Comparison is always, it's a bad killer. Thing. It's a killer. Yeah.
Yeah. And learning it is just about meeting needs and not so much being equal. Like what Ashley needs is different than what I need. And so right. I don't
It's more about equity, not equality.
Yes. Yeah. Totally.
Yeah.
And I think we figured that out by like bumping into hard times, like bumping into conflict. And I think what we've all prioritized is just wanting everyone to feel good, like wanting people to not have like hard nights, bad nights, like sad nights. And so if Ash is having trouble with her kids, like, and she's like, I'm having trouble, then I'm running over there, because we're just trying to like minimize bad experiences. Bottom line.
Mm-hmm. And maximize good ones.
Maximize good ones.
Yeah.
You ladies went on a couples retreat recently. Can you talk about that?
Oh, we needed it.
I was envious when I saw that. I was like, I want some.
Those girls need to get along. Otherwise, they're great. And I'm like, no, they're not, baby. I'm not a woo-woo person. Like I said, I'm very like macho, more of a tomboy. And she's a little bit more woo-woo crunchy. And so we got to this point that we just kept having conflict over nothing. It was just, we are not communicating. Like you're trying to bring up an idea, I'm not hearing it. And we both realized that, like, how are we messing up something with so much love? Our connection is so strong, but we could not figure it out. And so luckily Sonja's our little researcher and she went and found this amazing crunchy woo-woo, experience. And I was like, if this is what it takes to stay here with you, okay, I'm going to go meditate. Never done a day in my life. We went to Esalen. Up in Big Sur. It was gorgeous. And honestly, it was just what we needed. We realized that some of our like past traumas and our like vulnerabilities, we didn't know about each other. And so it's easier now to see why certain things upset Sonja or vice versa upset me. Is what we learned in that retreat. And they asked, like, we originally went there and they're like, well, where's your third? And we're like, we're in a throuple. And everyone like was like, radio silence. There's only one other gay couple and 25 other couples. And we're like, well, he's at home because this is a couples retreat.
Again, I was happily at home watching Marvel movies, playing golf.
And we're the ones that need work. So that's why we're here. And the entire time we were able to just talk about some of those issues that we had from our past that we were bringing in and our different attachment styles, etc. And we were able to work through it. And it was one of the best experiences I've had of my life, to be honest. I would, and someone that would never go to a, like barely can go to therapy.
I love it.
couples retreat. Yeah, it was shocking.
And the whole time, the way that Ash was able to like open up and be vulnerable, because she's the more quiet one, was like this. She had her face like 1 inch away from me. I think she gave me like 40,000 kisses over the 3 years. I don't think we lost physical touch the whole time. She's very, Ash is really physical. It's a beautiful
place if you get a chance.
So we just like connected physically really, really close. And it was, that's how we were able to be vulnerable with each other, is we had to just be like really physically connected. And that was a great thing for me to understand is that we can have really hard talks as long as we're like really physically connected in that moment. So we understand now that if we want to have a hard conversation, we are like naked in bed, curled up with the covers over our head. And then we can have those vulnerable chats, but we didn't know that. So we just like stand apart and like get mad at each other.
That's deep. I'm getting goosebumps. Yeah. That's so, so powerful to discover something like that. Also
realize that. Like, again, this goes back to like the different sides of the triangle work differently. Dave's like, you two really need time. And for that to be acceptable, and same, like Sonja, because they used to get a lot of time together prior to becoming a three, needed more time with Dave. So they were able to talk about that a couple weeks ago. And now this weekend, they're going to go on a date together, like a little adventure.
We're gonna go to the Lakers game.
We're gonna like do a little and it's just, I think they lost track of that time as well, so just kind of appreciating that all the relationships need time in a different way, because everybody has a different love language or style.
David, how did you feel when the girls were not in a good place and arguing all the time, and how was the difference for you after they came back from the retreat? Did you see any difference?
I mean in a throuple or a three-person relationship, it's really hard if the other two are having struggles and you don't have any control over making it better. So yeah, there have been times, I don't know about right before that retreat per se, but where I know they're having a difficult conversation, I'm not there. And it's super nerve wracking, to be honest, that you can't be a part of it to try and make it go well or set it up for success. So that is a struggle that you can have. When they came back from the retreat, it was amazing. It's been great. You could see they learned a lot and they shared it with me. And the great part, I'm like a cliff notes guy. She's our big researcher, but I got all the cliff notes of like learning things about both of them, and I didn't have to go, which was great for me as well. But I thought it was, they came back. It was awesome. And as a matter of fact, they're going to another one in a month or so.
Yeah.
Not because they're doing bad, but
accountability.
Because
accountability.
Nice.
That's awesome. Quite the opposite. Yeah, they've been doing great. So yeah, they came back and it was phenomenal. I was really, really happy.
I love it.
Beautiful. So what advice would you guys give to a throuple that's just starting out, brand new in this?
We kind of thought this is a hard question.
It's like it's kind of like being a new mom per se. Like you just don't know until you're in it. And I think like if we could go back, we would have asked more questions. We would have we checked in all the time, but we didn't even know what to ask. So it's like, I'm so happy for podcasts like yours and just information out there now that you can listen to and be like, I'm kind of wondering what I should even ask my other partner. Or I think communication would be our number one, like
for sure.
Just checking in and asking like, what are your expectations of this? Or like, if you're a couple and introducing a third, like what is the couple's expectations? What's the third's expectations? Like trying to identify things sooner, but for us, we really didn't even know. We were just living by the seat of our pants and going through a lot of divorces. So it was complicated, but I would say communication.
Yeah.
For sure.
Nice.
It's just hard. I think what my advice would be is, okay, you're going to go out there and you're going to look for some normalizing events. You're going to look for people that look like you, that are behaving like you, that might solve some of your issues. But ultimately, you have to figure out your own relationship. Mm-hmm. And that can work however you need it or want it to work. And there's going to be a lot of people out there like, you're a unicorn hunter, or you've got the couple's privilege. And they're going to sort of demonize some of the stuff that's just really present in your relationship and create shame. You've just got to go through your process with your people and set it up how it's going to work for you. So as much as you can listen to us and maybe get some good ideas that resonate, ultimately you have to do the work amongst your three and you have to get creative. That would be my advice.
Beautiful.
For me, I would say you wouldn't want to get involved in this if you're not really comfortable with who you are as a person.
Yeah.
That you have to be like your authentic self and comfortable with who you are and confident in how you show up. because it is going to challenge some different things. And I think if you know who you are, you're going to be able to walk through that a little bit easier. So just make sure that you check in with yourself as well, that you know that you're ready for it. It's great. I mean, I love it. This is amazing, an amazing relationship, but it adds some challenges for sure, with some massive upside as well, for sure.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Great opportunity for growth when you're in a throuple.
Yeah. I think it's ever evolving too. Like the needs keep changing, or what you think you need changes to what, you know, what you actually end up needing. I used to, in the beginning, I felt like whenever they were having a fight or an argument, I need to get in between it like a referee and try to solve the problem. And then it took a while to realize, like, I'm not really helping the situation. I should just remove myself from it and let them deal with it themselves.
Yeah. Facilitate, then, maybe, like, give the space.
But then, then it seemed to start going so much more smoother when I just removed myself and let them have time together just to figure it out, you know, their own relationship.
That's what I realized as well. These two have a similar communication pattern, which I don't understand. and they very rarely get in conflict because both of them will just bolt. Like, they're gonna like, rah, 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 and then they're just going to be like, bye, bye. And I wanted to be like, okay, now this is what I hear Ashley saying, and this is what I hear David say. Nah, like, just go take a shower.
I heard it.
Yeah. We only, I think, probably had three conflicts, Ashley and I, the whole time, but they literally are something like, I'll be like, screw you. She's like, screw you. And then we're like, we walk away the next morning, we act as if nothing it never happened.
Yeah, exactly. I think I have the same relationship with Liv, and it freaked Char out for the longest time because me and her will say something mean to each other. And then 10 minutes later, we're like hugging and kissing. Like, Char's like, what the hell is going on?
I don't do well with conflict. I don't communicate. I do now, but yeah.
Also, like you said, woo woo. Like, I didn't know what that term meant. I think we were at a trip in Vegas or something. Like, where's my woo woo girls at? And all of a sudden, I go deaf in one ear because she's going woo woo. Like, what the hell is that? So now I know what woo woo is.
I am the one that's always like woo.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The cheerleader. Yes.
We have to make adjustments. I mean, we said that from the beginning, like, your expectations in a relationship have changed. I mean, we went into this as like a fun sexual foursome with, like, everyone had two solid, you know, cores, like the couples were good, everyone had their own lives, jobs, like, and then I think when we became together, we transitioned not knowing that we would also like develop such a deep relationship. So we went in like, oh, it'll be a three, but like, Ashley, you're going to do your own thing and we're going to be a couple and we'll all be good. And then we kind of morphed that, like, oh, the feelings are changing. And so we've had to adjust over the past year to just a massive like expectation change. Like, we were in it for the more fun. Let's be home base. You do you, because I'm the wild one. But then we were like, I was like, no, I don't want to go be wild. Now I want to be with you. And they're like, bro, you know, now we got to all like change. Like, how can we shift it more time and I'll be three more than just two and one, or one and just adjusting,
evolving.
Evolving.
Yeah, when we first kind of went to three, that was so true, Ash. It really was a like, we'll be your home base, and you can be your wild, authentic self, because she's wild. And then, she kept being like, I don't want that. And we're like, yes, you do. This is who you are. This is your authentic self. And then she's like, I don't want that. And we're like, no, please. It'll be your authentic self over there. Yeah. But then we had to be like, okay, that is not her need. And so here we're on this journey, and it's been awesome.
I love it. That's amazing. Beautiful. So what is each of your favorite thing about being in a throuple?
For me, I had a hard upbringing, and I've just never been so loved authentically. Like, gets me a little bit weepy, but every time I turn around, every corner I turn, everyone I spend time with in this situation spreads, just gives me so much love. They just tell me that they're there. It's with their actions, with their words. I've never experienced so much unconditional, compassionate, kind love in my life. That's for me. What about you?
I think it's awesome that, I think the idea of one person that is supposed to check so many boxes for you is just not really realistic. I mean, these two do share a lot of things in common that I don't do, which is great. They go out, they're doing their running, they're doing their things. All the different pairs add something that wouldn't be there otherwise. So there's a lot more fun. I like to have fun. There's a lot more fun, in all things. There's a lot more love, a lot more, support when you're doing things. And I'll throw it out there too. The sex isn't bad. That part is pretty good.
What about you, Ash?
Well, I'm one, like, not a monogamous person. I don't really, like, monogamy is, I kind of agree with Dave. Like, I don't know that I truly believe that one necessarily is, like, the one forever. Mm-hmm. So I do love having multiple. And I love the balance that I get. So I can, like, party, have all the fun with Dave and sort of Sonja. But then I get to have the, like, workout, the adventure racing, the, like, camping side of me. Like, I get to be with two people that really bring out the best in me. And that's, like, a selfish way of saying it. But it really is so nice after my last partner not really being really involved in all my hobbies. Now all of my hobbies are met between two people. And so I feel very satisfied.
That's perfect. I love it. Amazing. Yeah. You guys are just have been so fun to talk to.
You're just this so has been an amazing conversation. You are inspiring.
Yeah. And thank you so much for being so open.
Good sex talks. We should do a whole nother one on that.
Yes. Well, thank you guys so much for being open on Instagram and in your community and just helping to show the world that relationships, healthy relationships, loving relationships come in all shapes and sizes. It's amazing.
Yeah. And we talked about Dr. Rachel Maier.
Yes.
So don't forget, if anybody needs any therapy or great relationship coaches, go to throupletherapy.com.
Yeah,
she's awesome.
She's amazing. She's awesome. She's really been a great help for us. But we're so thankful for you guys as well. You know, putting yourselves out there in such a big way, going on national TV, being our spokespeople, creating this container for us to share and have fun and laugh about this unique relationship structure. You know, you're such a resource in our community as well. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Happy to do it. Thank you.
If you like our episodes, don't forget to subscribe and share them with people just like yourselves.
And all you throuples out there, please connect with us on Facebook and Throuple Talks Connection Hub.
And we'll see you next time.